Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The First Rule of Mastery, Stop Worrying About What People Think of You, by Michael Gervais, PhD, with Kevin Lake. Narrated by Michael Gervais. Introduction. Everything that irritates us about others can lead us to an understanding of ourselves. Carl Jung. When we give more value to other people's opinions than our own, we live life on their terms, not ours. Softball star Lauren Regula grappled with that dilemma in the ramp-up to the 2020 Olympics. Having retired from the sport 11 years earlier, Regula was presented with an opportunity of a lifetime to play again for Team Canada on the sport's biggest stage. To win an Olympic medal after coming tantalizingly close in 2008, when she came in fourth after a heartbreaking loss in the bronze medal game in Beijing. The Canadian coach called Regula, a 39-year-old mom with three children and a business with her husband, and tried to lure her out of retirement to take a final shot at winning an Olympic medal. In the movie version of this story, Lauren probably screams with joy. Her reaction serves as an emotional apex, a prime spot for swells of sentimental strings. But in the real version, she hesitated. In her heart, she knew she wanted to do it, but there were challenges and doubts. Having been to two prior Olympics, she was also aware she wasn't going to train for a couple of weeks and go home. The pursuit of her dream would mean significant time away from her children, now 11, 10, and 8 years old. Adding to the complexity, the athletes would only be able to leave the quarantine bubble one time in the 6 months leading up to the games. Being a mom, it wasn't an easy decision to say yes to attempting to make an Olympic roster, she told me. Never mind a mom who had only spent a few months on a field, working at her sport in the last 12 years. Never mind a mom who owns and runs a business with her hubby. But ultimately, it wasn't age, the extended layoff, or the years she had spent battling postpartum depression that threatened to derail her from Tokyo. It was a gnawing concern for what other people think. Here's Lauren in her own words. When I shared my story of training and travel and my dedication to this dream, these are some of the comments I received. Oh my gosh, I could never do that. I could never leave my family for that long. Insert mom judgment. You still think you can do it? I mean, aren't you afraid you'll never be as good as you were? Insert, who the hell do you think you are, judgment? Aren't you, like, the oldest player ever? Insert age judgment. Is Dave okay with you playing and leaving? Insert wife and abandoning my family judgment. I stressed about those negative conversations. I stressed about what other people thought about me and my decision. I stressed about other people thinking I was a bad mom and a bad wife, that I was too old, that I'll never be able to do it. And it really made me pause. My world was revolving around what others thought of my decision. Now, I had more positive opinions than negative. However, I found the negative opinions to be way more magnetic. They held more weight at the time. Being stuck on those negative words, as I see it now, reminds me of one of my favorite quotes. One tree can make 1,000 matches, and one match can burn 1,000 trees. Lauren was wrestling with her assessment of herself against the assessment of her by others. Her dilemma was a challenge we all face in different forms. Do we follow our own internal directives or conform to societal norms and expectations? To put it another way, Lauren suffered from FOPO, the fear of people's opinions, and it almost cost her one last shot at her dream. An invisible limit. Our fear of people's opinions, FOPO, is a hidden epidemic and maybe the single greatest constrictor of human potential. Our concern with what other people think about us has become an irrational, unproductive, and unhealthy obsession in the modern world. And its negative effects reach into all aspects of our lives. When we experience FOPO, we lose faith in ourselves and our performance suffers. That's human nature. But if we're not careful, FOPO can take over the narrative in our minds, slowly poisoning us. Instead of focusing on our own thoughts and feelings, we start obsessing about the thoughts and opinions of others, whether spoken or perceived, and this obsession can affect our decisions and actions and our lives. Think about Lauren. If she had let her negative thoughts, her fear of people's opinions, take over, she would have missed out on one last chance to do what she'd spent her entire life training to do. FOPO is part of the human condition because we're operating with an ancient brain. A craving for social approval made our ancestors cautious and savvy thousands of years ago. If the responsibility for the failed hunt fell on your shoulders, your place in the tribe could be threatened. But today, with the proliferation of social media, the intense pressure to succeed, especially at an early age, and our over-reliance on external rewards, metrics, and validation, FOPO is running rampant. You can see FOPO in action when leaders don't speak up and make tough decisions, or when CEOs privileged short-term shareholder gains over the long-term health of their companies, and when politicians vote with their party instead of their conscience. The sooner you fundamentally change your relationship with other people's opinions, the sooner you become free. Totally free to be at home with yourself wherever you are. FOPO shows up almost everywhere in our lives, and the consequences are great. We play it safe and we play it small because we're afraid of what will happen on the other side of critique. When challenged, we go full-on porcupine, protecting our egos with our version of sharp quills, or we surrender our viewpoint. We trade in authenticity for approval. We don't raise our hand when we can't control the outcome. We try to read the room, not out of benevolence, but for belonging. We laugh when it's not funny. We bite our tongue when somebody says something offensive. We formulate our response while listening. We pursue power rather than purpose. We please rather than provoke. We chase the dreams of others rather than our own. We externalize our self-esteem, our sense of value. We see ourselves through the eyes of others. We look outside of ourselves to determine how we feel about ourselves. If people approve of us or the choices we make, we feel great. If others disapprove of us or the choices we make, we feel terrible. We scamper around the world trying to please others and being who we think people want us to be, rather than who we are. We are unaware of our own needs, or we dismiss our needs as we hustle for our self-worth. We will have spent our brief time on this incredible planet playing a role, inhabiting an identity, conforming to the perceived expectations of others. We will never discover who we are truly capable of becoming. Now, think about your decisions you've made in your life. Did you choose your career path because you were passionate about the field? Or did you pursue law or business or whatever because that's what you're supposed to do? Or let me put it this way, have you ever felt the urge to make a change in your life or boldly step into a new challenge, but didn't because of what other people might think? We all have. But here's the thing. If you started paying less and less attention to what makes you, you, your talents, beliefs, and values, and start conforming to what others may or may not think, you'll dramatically limit your potential and your pursuit of mastery. We all have unique qualities and strengths, and it's our job to make the most of them. We're always in a state of becoming, and that state, that striving for becoming the person we want to be, is tenuous and easily lost amid the internal and external pressures of daily life. It takes deep inner resolve and vision to pull off. If you're overly influenced by outside forces, such as other people's opinions or societal pressures, they can box you in and limit what's possible. Instead of making the next move, you may tell yourself, "The odds are against me," or "I'm not smart enough." Instead of making a career change, you may say, "I'm too old." If left unexamined, these stories can feel real, true, and immutable. The desire to fit in and the paralyzing fear of being disliked undermine our ability to pursue the lives we want to create. Though our ancient brains make FOPO an everyday reality, that doesn't mean we don't need to obsess over it. to prevent us from doing what we want to do. Space in between. Woody Hoberg's story underscores the possibility that opens up when we follow our own path and don't succumb to the opinions of others. Woody is one of the best humans I've ever met. He fires on all cylinders, emotionally, psychologically, intellectually, and physically. His sense of adventure is matched only by his curiosity and humility. Since he was a kid, he loved to climb, and he dreamed of going to space. Woody earned a bachelor's degree in aeronautics and astronautics from MIT and went on to Berkeley to pursue his doctorate in computer science. Woody loved solving technical, hard problems, but he had another side of him that didn't feel captured on that path. At Berkeley, he was climbing on the weekends in nearby Yosemite, and he was flying planes, but he wanted his adventures to be more structured and meaningful. He wanted to put his skills to work in a job that was purposeful. He came up with the idea of getting his EMT certification and applying to the Yosemite Search and Rescue Team. Performing mountain rescues is completely unrelated to pursuing a PhD in computer science, so Woody sought the counsel of his academic mentors, people he deeply respected and still considers friends and mentors to this day. He was fascinated by how many of them tried to discourage him, telling him things like, "I don't think it's such a good idea. I'm not sure how that's going to help you in what you're pursuing." The opinions of academics carry weight when you are on the academia track. As described by Woody, these are people I deeply trust and respect, and I wanted to listen to their opinions. But Woody resisted the temptation to conform. At the end of the day, I just had to make a choice. I just knew I was going to do it, and I'm so glad I did because it was one of the best experiences of my life. Woody finished his PhD at Berkeley, started teaching at MIT, and was training in a climbing gym when his best friend told him NASA was accepting applications for astronauts after a 4-year hiatus. Woody filled out an internet form at usajobs.gov and pressed submit with what he deemed to be a zero probability of getting in. A year and a half later, he was one of 12 candidates selected for the astronaut class from more than 18,000 qualified applicants. At the time of this writing, Dr. Hoberg is at the International Space Station at the front end of a 6-month mission. He and I just finished recording the first ever podcast from outer space. Why did Woody get selected? He believes joining Yosemite Search and Rescue distinguished his candidacy. His refusal to bow to the pressure of other people's opinions punched his ticket to space and allowed him to realize his childhood dream. In the trenches. As a high-performance psychologist, I've had the privilege of working with some of the most extraordinary individuals and teams across the planet. I was on the sidelines when the Seattle Seahawks won Super Bowl 48 against the Denver Broncos. I sat in mission control when Austrian base jumper Felix Baumgartner made his record-breaking space jump from 24 miles above Earth's surface, free-falling at over 800 miles an hour. I was on the beaches of Tokyo when USA Surfing won the first Olympic gold medal in the history of the sport. I was courtside when Kerry Walsh Jennings and Misty May Traynor, arguably the best female beach volleyball team of all time, won 3 golds in 3 consecutive Olympics. I was in the room with the CEO of the world's largest tech company when the company set course to be the first enterprise organization to build a culture based on mindset, empathy, and purpose. The best performers in the world push past the perceived limits of human potential and expand our notions of what's possible. In my experience, they aren't merely exceptional at their craft. Beyond a relentless pursuit of being their best, what drives these high performers is a striving for inner excellence. They're in constant pursuit of mastery. And it's not easy. Though we tend to look at athletes, actors, leaders, and musicians as superhumans who possess innate physical skills and mental toughness, reality is much more complicated. In fact, success, especially when achieved in the public eye, makes us more susceptible to FOPO. Imagine being subjected to a 24/7 feedback loop of criticism and praise from fans, media, and social media users. If you're a pop star or an actress, imagine having to constantly read comments and reviews about your voice, your looks, and your abilities. Wouldn't that gnaw at you, too? Or imagine dedicating your entire life to making it to the pinnacle of your sport and realizing that the allure of power and fame can be a trap that leads to loneliness and depression. Or imagine if your success in life was measured by a simple metric, wins. This can be especially hard for Olympians who train their entire lives for a single event, which, in some cases, lasts less than a minute. Imagine finishing in fourth place, a blink of an eye away from medaling. We see this in corporate life too. The higher you rise on the career ladder, the more susceptible you are to scrutiny and public opinion. Leaders have the power to make decisions that significantly impact stakeholders, employees, customers, shareholders, and the general public. And their actions and decisions are more likely to attract attention and opinions from these groups. Media coverage further amplifies public opinions and puts additional pressure on leaders to manage their public image effectively, which is why leadership is rife with FOPO. My point is that focusing on externals, things that are beyond our control, is all too common and doesn't magically go away with success. That's why it's important to begin the process and mental work of changing our focus to what we can control, ourselves. Mastery in any area of life, the arts, business, parenting, sports, requires being able to differentiate what is and is not within our control. When we place attention on things outside our control, we take our focus and energy away from what we can control. Hence, the first rule of mastery requires looking within and fundamentally committing to work on mastering what's 100% under your control. There is nothing else that can be mastered. This is the essence of the path. Leaning into FOPO. In high-performing sports, athletes front-load awareness and psychological skill building so that when they are faced with a challenge, they have internal tools to successfully navigate the experience. That same approach applies to transforming our relationship with the perceived opinions and judgments of others. The ambition of this book is to illuminate a psychological process that lives just beneath the surface and turn it into your best teacher. Use FOPO as an opportunity. Start to identify it in your life. Use your reactions as a springboard to a better understanding of yourself. Recognize how you are choosing to think and behave in response to the perceived judgments of others. Each chapter provides an insight or lesson in how to use FOPO to unlock your potential. Rather than running away from or ignoring FOPO, choose to see it as a learning opportunity, a potential stepping stone to unlocking your potential. Use it to discover aspects of yourself that have remained hidden. When FOPO surfaces, lean in to discover what's underneath the fear. For example, you have a great idea in a client meeting, but you don't raise your hand. Investigate what that's about. Do you want the idea to be fully worked out before you dare to share it? Are you afraid you won't be able to eloquently express yourself? Are you concerned that your idea won't be received well? If the latter, what if people don't embrace your idea? Does that mean you're not competent? Or that you're not good enough? Keep pulling on that thread to discover what's at the root of your fear. What is the story you're telling yourself? Developing an awareness of our fears about the opinions of others is the first step to discharging the power they hold over us. Awareness as the starting point for change is not a novel idea. Every self-development book, every New Year's Eve resolution, every 12-step program is anchored in awareness. We cannot even contemplate change unless we are aware of the challenge we want to address. But awareness is only the first step. Awareness must be accompanied by psychological skill building. Someone could be having a panic attack and be acutely aware that their thoughts are driving it, but lack the skills to work with those thoughts. Lauren is a prime example. She did not allow FOPO to dictate the course of her life. A year delayed because of the pandemic, she went to Tokyo with Team Canada in 2021 and, at the age of 39, found herself standing on the Olympic podium holding a bronze medal. Lauren, though, did not forget that her dream could have easily been derailed. FOPO is real, and I almost let it get in my way. Thank goodness I didn't. Thank goodness I had the confidence to listen to me. So ask yourself, is FOPO holding you back? Chapter 1. Beethoven's Secret. An artist must never be a prisoner of himself, prisoner of a style, prisoner of a reputation, prisoner of success. Henri Matisse. No one is immune to FOPO. Not you, not me, not world-class athletes. Even renowned artists, such as one of the greatest and most prolific composers ever, get waylaid by FOPO's power. But only after we confront FOPO's forces can we truly set forth on the path to mastery. Consider Beethoven. To many people, he seemed like a vessel handpicked by God to channel music from a higher plane. His work transformed every genre of classical music. He broke all the rules to create some of the most transcendent music the world has ever known. He embodied the idea of the creative genius who railed against convention and forged his own artistic path. Despite being one of the most fearless artists to ever walk the planet, Beethoven lived for 3 years in abject fear of others' opinions. Near the apex of his career, Beethoven receded from public view. He carried a secret that he thought, if revealed, would destroy his professional life. The archetypal creative artist, seemingly born to struggle against fate and the injustices of the world, chose to socially isolate rather than utter 3 words aloud. I am deaf. Beethoven started losing his hearing in his mid-20s. The cruel irony of losing the sense most relevant to his art and livelihood drove him on a futile search for cures, ranging from almond earplugs to baths to toxic tree bark. During those early years, he did not talk about his deteriorating hearing to anyone outside of the medical community. As he was increasingly externally celebrated in society, he was trapped alone inside a world with his own distressing thoughts and feelings. To conceal his hearing loss, he masqueraded behind the trope of the genius artist whose brain was preoccupied with other intellectual activity. When he couldn't hear what someone said or a sound they referenced, the other person would assume, with Beethoven's influence, that it was a function of inattention or forgetfulness. It is surprising that some people have never noticed my deafness, but since I have always been liable to fits of absent-mindedness, they attribute my hardness of hearing to that. Sometimes, too, I can scarcely hear a person who speaks softly. I can hear sounds. It's true, but cannot make out the words. But if anyone shouts, I can't bear it. Heaven alone knows what is to become of me. Beethoven was deeply concerned about the impact his hearing loss would have on his music, especially his ability to play the piano, but public perception presented an equally powerful threat. If I belonged to any other profession, it would be easier. But in my profession, it is an awful state. The more since my enemies, who are not few, what would they say? He feared that his detractors would use the revelation against him. He was worried their criticism would lead to discrimination against him and exclusion from the Viennese music circles that he had toiled for so long to access. Beethoven, like other artists of the times, was dependent on aristocratic patronage. Overcoming the stigma might be a taller hill to climb than the loss of hearing itself. But the greatest threat of all may have been to Beethoven's identity. Ah, how could I possibly admit such an infirmity in the one sense which should have been more perfect in me than in others? A sense which I once possessed in highest perfection, a perfection such as few surely in my profession enjoy or have enjoyed. He wrote to his brother. He was Beethoven, the music god, and music gods were supposed to hear music better than mortals. His auditory loss did not fit with the idea he held of himself or the public image he promoted. He had a rigid identity, conditioned upon approval and praise from others, that was as real and immutable to him as his skin and bones. As reflected in a letter to his generous benefactor, Prince Lichnowsky, his identity bordered on myth-making. Prince, what you are by circumstance and by birth. What I am through myself. Of princes there have been and will be thousands. Of Beethovens, there is only one. Beethoven responded how most of us respond when we feel our survival is threatened. He tried to protect himself. Rather than looking inward and altering the way he saw himself, he looked outward and tried to conform external reality to his perception of himself. Beethoven paid an exorbitant price to architect a reality that kept the opinions of other people at bay. He often couldn't hear people talk, but was afraid to ask them to speak louder for fear of being found out. He played the role of misanthrope to keep his secret hidden. He spent several years isolated from society, alone in his deafness, even contemplating suicide. Daddy problems. From a young age, Beethoven had been conditioned to believe external opinions mattered. His father, Johann, a mediocre tenor whose own music aspirations were thwarted by alcoholism, sought to live out his dreams through his son. He appointed himself as Beethoven's instructor and verbally and physically abused Beethoven to push him harder. He kept him in line with shouts, threats, and beatings, even locking him in the basement. On one occasion, after returning from a night out with friends, Johann made little Beethoven stand on a stool to reach the piano keys and perform for his friends, beating him whenever he missed a note. As the young Beethoven's talents became more apparent, Johann set his sights on becoming Europe's next music sensation. Johann played the role of 18th century stage dad, a marketeer who promoted Beethoven across all music circles in Bonn, Germany. When Beethoven was 7, his father lied about his age by a year to more closely fit the archetype of prodigy. He rented a hall in Cologne and took out an ad in the local newspaper advertising his little son of 6 years, who had already had the honor of playing for the court. From a young age, Beethoven was given the not-so-subtle message, "You are not enough as you are." Early on, Beethoven recognized that his upward movement through the music world of 19th-century Vienna would be directly correlated to the status and opinions of those who admired him. On a deeper level, he had firsthand experience that approval and love came in response to performance and achievement. His father's actions sent a clear message that Beethoven was loved not for who he was, but for what he did. The fusion of love and approval often creates a pattern of approval seeking in later life, and the spotlight fueled Beethoven's sense of self. Sanctuary. Beethoven had one place he could go that was impenetrable to the opinions of others, inhospitable to self-doubt, and beyond the reach of the aristocratic patrons who provided the financial lifeline for his music, his inner world. Beethoven developed the ability to fully immerse himself in his music and disappear inside of himself, oblivious to his surroundings and without any sense of self-consciousness. He could be anywhere, scribbling in his notebooks or improvising amid a great crowd. A childhood friend recalled one of those moments. She was talking to Beethoven, but he seemed to be absent, unable to hear her. When he finally snapped back, he responded, "Oh, please, no, forgive me. I was busy with such a beautiful deep thought, I couldn't bear to be disturbed." Biographer Jan Swafford described it as a trance, where he found solitude even in company. A family friend who was instrumental in shaping Beethoven's early career gave the state of mind a name, raptus. Beethoven's raptus became a legend among those in Beethoven's inner circle. When he would withdraw, it wouldn't be uncommon to hear, "He has his raptus again today." With his raptus, Beethoven developed an internal skill set that allowed him to focus on his music and block out internal and external distractions. He was able to go to a place where the opinions of others did not matter. He was comfortable venturing inside his own cave because he knew how to be with himself. He knew how to listen to his own music. The challenge was when he emerged from raptus and was back in the approval game. Facing FOPO. Beethoven reached a point where it was getting impossible to conceal his deafness. He described his bind in a heartfelt and anguished letter he wrote to his brothers on October 6, 1802, known as the Heiligenstadt Testament. "Oh, you men who think or say that I am malevolent, stubborn, or misanthropic, how greatly do you wrong me. You do not know the secret cause."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.